Hey, blowout friends, thank you so much for joining me tonight. I wish I could be there with y'all, but I guess I get to be on the big screen. I bet my head looks absolutely huge. But tonight I want to talk a little bit about Lent and Ash Wednesday, because I remember when I went to church when I was younger and they placed these ashes on my forehead and a cross, and they said that kind of weird, creepy, morbid phrase, "From dust you came, to dust you will return," and then I had to wear it around for the rest of the day. And then my parents asked me, like, "What are you going to give up now for 40 days?" It was all like super confusing to me. And I was like, why do we do all this? None of it like made any sense. Like, what's the point of putting some dust on my head and then giving something up for 40 days? And nobody really answered that question for me. So I never really grasped the idea of Lent or Ash Wednesday. But over the last few years, I've started to kind of learn what it meant. And to be honest, it's become one of the most influential ways that I connect with Jesus and prepare my heart to serve as his hands and feet in the world. So I want to talk about that a little bit tonight, about Lent, about fasting, about those ashes, and see if we can come to a better understanding of what all of that means. And hopefully you'll maybe actually be a little more excited to get those things on your forehead or give something up. But before we get to that, I first want to ask you a question. When you have something super big coming up in your life, what do? Whether it be like a test that's coming up, right? You're going to study for that. You're not just going to go take the test willy-nilly and see what happens. Or maybe some of you do, but you're probably not getting great grades then. Or if you have a big game coming up, you go and practice, you lift weights. If you have a play coming up, you run through your lines because you don't want to get on stage and look like an idiot if you forget something. Or if you have a dance, you practice your steps. Or maybe if it's a big date that's coming up, or you're asking a girl something or a really important question, you look in the mirror, you fix your hair, and you kind of practice what you're going to say in the mirror, your lines, to make sure like what comes out of your mouth is gonna sound good. I know some of you are probably not dating yet and looking at me like I'm crazy, but when you're in high school or college, I know that you will be doing that, and maybe you'll remember this lesson or what Josh said. But the reality is, when we're preparing for something big in our lives, we set our minds, our hearts, our focus, and our time on it, because we want to be prepared, we want to notice, we want to be in the moment and focused on what's going on. The idea behind Lent is taking the time to prepare our hearts and our minds to remember and celebrate the gift of Easter, to put our focus on all that Jesus has done for us and how he loved us so much to die on the cross, so that we could have the opportunity to spread his message of hope, love, joy, and peace for all of our siblings in Christ throughout the world to hear. Lent's this time to get ready, to focus and to notice all the ways that God is working, so that we can fully remember the gift of Easter when it comes. And it's how it's our turn now to continue Jesus' ministry, because his spirit lives and is working in our hearts. He's gifted each and every one of us. You see, the idea of Lent is based around these stories in the gospel where Jesus is led into the wilderness for 40 days, where he is tempted by the devil, where he has no food, where he has no water. But in this challenging moment in this wilderness, he prepares his heart. He draws closer to God. He sees God's strength, and it actually begins and preps him to start his ministry to the world. You see, right after this story, right after this time in the wilderness, he goes out, he calls his disciples, he starts spreading his message, he begins healing, and his kingdom movement, his movement of spreading love and grace and kindness to the ends of the earth, is unleashed. And so I want to read you this story from the gospel where we get this idea of Lent. And it's in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, but tonight we're going to look at Luke 4, 1 through 13. And it's going to feel really weird, me reading when I'm not in person, but we'll try it. I feel weird reading to a screen, but hopefully it goes well. So Luke 4, 1 through 13 says this: "Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and at the end of them, he was hungry." At his absolute lowest point, this is when the devil starts to tempt him. And I think for many of us in our lives, like when we're at our lowest points, when things are difficult, that's when the devil comes in. So the devil recognizes this, and the devil goes to Jesus and says to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread. Remember, Jesus is starving. And Jesus answered, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone. Not today, Satan. The devil then leads him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me, and I can give it to anyone I want to. If you worship me, it will all be yours. Right? It sounds pretty good, right? But Jesus then answers again, not today, Satan. It is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. The devil then leads him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. That would have been about 150 feet in the air. And the devil says this, if you are the Son of God, he said, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, God will command God's angels concerning you to guard you carefully. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. Jesus answered, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. So we see in here that Jesus is led out into the wilderness, at a time where he is strengthened, where he grows, where he is tempted, but he also sees God work through him, and it prepares him for his ministry to the world. You see, the wilderness throughout the Bible is a metaphor for growth moments in our lives that help strengthen our relationship with God, with Jesus, and with ourselves. We all have wilderness moments, whatever those may be. But when we go through them, we learn how we can fully live into the people we're called to be. If you look throughout all the scriptures, almost every person in the Bible, before they begin their ministry to the world, enters the wilderness. And it's this time of growth, but it also sets them on their path. For Lent, we're trying to kind of go through that in our own lives. We fast or we give up something for 40 days to remember how Jesus prepared himself for ministry, but also to prepare our hearts for the coming of Easter, to remember what Jesus went through and to draw closer to God. Giving something up for Lent is an intentional way to figure out and notice how Jesus is working in your lives. The thing I never realized when I was younger is Lent isn't necessarily just about fasting or giving something up, but it's also about adding something in. When I was younger, I would always just give something up. And it was always like, when we just give something up, like, what's the point? It's hard. It's struggling. Like, we want these things. But what I've learned growing up is that, like, I give something up, but then I add something in as well. For me, I absolutely love cookies. I think M&M cookies are the best. I think they're 10 million times better than chocolate chip. I obviously lost that in the this or that, but you were all wrong. M&M cookies, way better than chocolate chip. But one year I gave up cookies. And every time that I craved or wanted a cookie, what I would do is then I would go read my Bible or watch a devotional or pray. So like I added that in. When I had that desire for the cookie, I added a way to connect with God in. Or one year I gave up video games, and I play way too many video games. And so instead of playing video games, I volunteered my time throughout those 40 days. And it became a practice that I continued. So I encourage you to do that, to find something that you can give up, but then add something else that connects you or helps you notice how God is working in your life more. Because when we just give something up because it's something the church tells us to do or our parents are making us do it, it doesn't make much sense. But when we realize we're giving something up so that we can grow closer to God, I think it changes our mindset a little bit. When you stop doing something you're used to doing, like eating dessert, you notice different things. Lent is a time when we choose to pause, to take a breath, to take a rest, to take a break. I know I just said a word and you're probably all gonna laugh, but I'm not gonna trigger it, go back and record this. But for me, like Lent is all about taking that rest, taking a time to notice the small moments, the little ways that God is working in our lives. And so I challenge you all to do that this year, to take a step back. We're all busy, but we're never too busy to notice the way God is working in our lives and the way that we're called to work in others' lives. So maybe that answers the question about Lent and the idea of giving something up. But what about those weird ashes and that morbid saying, from dust you came and dust you shall return? Let's try to answer that question real quickly. Some people will say that that's a symbol that represents our death or our mortality. It's a reminder of the pain, suffering, and the loss are all a part of life. It's a reminder to turn away from sin and move toward God. And that's true, but I choose to look at it in a little bit of a different way. You see, Lent actually means spring, to move forward. You know, like the season of new life. If you look out, all the trees and are dead, all the leaves have fallen, but in the spring, there's this new life, there's this color, there's this vibrancy, there's this joy. That's the idea of Lent. It's rebirth, it's new life, it's joy. That phrase, from dust you came and to dust you will return, comes from Genesis 3, which is actually the story about the fall. It's where everything goes wrong. It's where Adam and Eve eat from the apple and then they get punished by God. Now, you can look at that story as a story of sin, but I also think that it's a story of God's grace. It's a story of God's love and a story of the beginning of God's rebirth and his restoration project for the world. Yes, it is where everything falls apart, but it's also where everything begins. Yeah, I see the ashes not as something to make us think of sin or a reminder of pain, but as a symbol of grace and love. They are a symbol that God takes the brokenness and brings it into life and turns it into something beautiful. That God created us perfectly as we are, and yes, we'll make mistakes. Yes, we'll screw up. But God also has trusted us to be his partners in helping him restore his kingdom to the world. You see, when Jesus dies on the cross, for many people, they think it's simply about him saving us from our sins so that we can experience heaven or salvation when we die. But salvation isn't the end game of our lives. It's not just about what happens after our lives. Salvation is about getting to experience God's love, his joy, his freedom every single day of our lives here, and then spreading that joy and love to everybody that we come in contact to. Lent is the time that we prepare our hearts to both be loved by Jesus, but that we also prepare our hearts so that we can begin our ministry to the world and share God's love with everyone. Lent is about preparing our hearts for Easter, because Easter is when we celebrate that the tomb is empty, that death and darkness are defeated and love wins, but it's also the invitation for us to begin our ministry, to live fully into the sacrifice and the incredible act of love and the new life Jesus offers us. It's the beginning. It's our opportunity to spread the message of grace, peace, hope, and love for all people to the ends of the earth to hear. So will we be ready? Will we be prepared? Will we go through the wilderness experiences so that our hearts can be prepared as we enter our ministry into this world? So guys, I challenge you, what are you going to give up this year? How are you going to try and notice God in the small moments of your life? There's this video that I want to watch. I want you guys to watch after this. Hannah's going to play it. And it's a video that kind of shows what Jesus experienced in the wilderness. Somebody made it during their time in Lent where they gave up something. And for their extra thing, they added in this. And it gives a whole bunch of pictures of what Jesus experienced. And I want you to watch it and try to just relate to it and see how it speaks in your life. And after it, we're going to give you some time in small groups to reflect on the video and what I just talked about. I love you guys. I wish I was there with you all tonight. And no, I'm not giving up Blowout for Lent. I hope I'll see you all next Wednesday. So let's pray. Dear God, thank you for the opportunity to gather here today. Thank you for reminding us of your great love for us. As we journey through this season of Lent, teach us how to give so that we can joyfully respond when you call us to serve. Teach us how to pray so that we can be closer to you in all that we do throughout each day. Teach us how to let go so nothing can stand in the way of our connection with you. Help us notice you in all of the small moments. Teach us how to prepare so that we can be ready to receive your love, your wisdom, and your blessing and spread it to the world. Help us to remember that in all ways we belong and that we are loved by you. God, we love you. We thank you for loving us. Amen.